Welcome to Fear Porn Propaganda, where we will discuss today's issue.
Jade Helm. 15. And the Walmart closures.
Okay,
there you go. So welcome, everyone. I'm Wisecraft, and I'm with...
Anon 2150.
So what's on your mind today, man?
Well, we got some guests today, and I know that everybody is eager to speak and get their points across and stuff. But yeah, let's lead into it. Pretty much what we've got here is like a society,
Jade Helm.
More like society 50. Beholden to corporations, and yeah, that's all bad and everything because of the results that we see of that are a culture of violence and greed. And this is leading us into, a future that projects violence, you know. So our government is involved in getting themselves set up in case there's some sort of a revolt against this type of oligarchy that we have, ruled by the rich, essentially. And the military industrial complex is preparing for us to become fed up with it at some point. And if we, you know, choose a violent revolt, then we'll find ourselves in a similar position where they've got the upper hand. Regardless of the fact that the United States is the most heavily armed citizenship in the world, probably, chances are we may not stand a chance against what they've got ready for us. So, they're doing some drills, and my friend Keith, who's been doing a tremendous amount, a tremendous amount of research about...
He outed me!
Yeah. So, take it away, my friend. You've got some Jade Helm research.
Alrighty.
Eager to hear.
Awesome. So first of all, we have the Jade Helm name, right? And it's Jade Helm 15. It's a realistic mystery, military training, and that means it's a dissident extraction exercise. It's conducted on American soil without the public's knowledge, other than essentially going to city council meetings. So if you're not in the city council meeting, like say if you're like a homeless person, you're probably not going to get into a city council meeting, and you wouldn't even know this existed. So, and also poor people generally don't go to those, just advocates and such. So those people are going to know what's going on, but the other people aren't. So the presentation to Tom Green County is one that I was focusing on, and it happened in San Angelo, Texas, March 10th, 2015. I looked at that, and I've been kind of in between watching it, and I'd like to show you people, but I'm not sure how to get it to where you can hear it and all that. So, if Haplo, do you have the ability to show stuff online, like with sound and all that?
Oh, yeah, I could do that, I guess.
Like, I could send you the link.
I'll pull up. There it is. Boom. I could send stuff. Whatever you want.
I'm not sure if it'll come through. Let's try it.
Tell me about the district that they've got going. They've set up certain Jade Helm exercises all around the country, right? There's like 7 different exercises or so.
Right. So like
7 regions.
Let's see. So I have stuff already.
If I could chime in here.
Go ahead.
All right.
From my perspective and what I've done and know and my mindset, this is a testing. It's like a testing 1, 2, 3, which has been, you could see it if you know what you're looking for, something the CIA or other government agencies with the same type of mindset might be involved in to see what the reactions are, because if they really wanted to do this and they wanted it to be completely covert, They would, because there have been completely covert things happening right in the United States of America, right in the front of everybody, and nobody knew about it, and it was military action. People seem to think that this is the first time that they have done things like this on U.S. soil. Not true. These things have been going on for a long time. So this is, to me, is what is the reasoning for them wanting people to know this, because people didn't have to know about any of this. Right. It could have been completely covert. And in my tactical training, got to look behind what's behind this. Why is all of this information being released? Is this a diversion? What is happening behind the scene? It's kind of looking behind what is being shown. To me, it screams that this is a diversion. This is a tactical diversion to throw people off on the real deal that's going on. Where are they at? What are they doing? What are they moving? What is really going on? That was my first response to hearing this. I said to myself, and then talking to some of my friends that are still in the military, and just kind of quietly speaking about it here and there, not saying too much. We kind of have our own little way of talking without saying too much, but we know exactly what we're saying. Got to the point where we figured this. There is something more going on. And then I don't have anybody directly linked to this operation, so it's kind of in the dark, but we all have ideas. And I really do think that this is a diversion. This is also to test what people will think if this happens for real. This is just a training session. They have let people know to see what the response from the American people will be and the world community, because everybody around the world knows about it. They want to know what people think, and they're gauging the response from the public.
Okay. Yeah, well, exactly. And one of the things I wanted to point it out is what it means. Like, the JADE means Joint Assistant for Development and Execution, and it's Homeland Eradication of Local Militants.
Yep.
So, I even put in a note of the side note, Program for General and Complete Disarmament in a Peaceful World is their perspective.
Yep. This is actually a NATO operation, by the way. This is not directly. It is using U.S. military, but it's a sanctioned NATO operation. Now, that's something that's not plastered everywhere, but that is something I do know, that this is a NATO thing.
Yeah, I've heard this theory that parts of the law that are written into it is, if our troops, like American troops, refuse to fight, then they can go ahead and bring in like mercenaries and foreign legion and shit like that.
Yes, there are NATO forces all over the world that will do exactly what they're told when NATO comes along.
Yep. No shortage of people that if you pay them, they will kill people.
That's right.
for the presentation in Tom Green County. It starts out, he kind of comes on around like 10, like about 9 minutes in, no, about 8 minutes in. So started out 8 minutes in.
You can. All right, let's do it.
Rattlesnakes, bobcats, things like that, to be able to...
You hear that?
Really loud.
No, I mean, we can hear it, but could you hear that, Hapla?
I can.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Then it was playing through, so I can hear it then.
Yeah.
That's easier. But I didn't think it was going to play through.
Yeah, I can actually see the video too.
So this is the dude that's putting it on, and you know this is like from the horse's mouth, so we can hear it from their perspective.
Was this the CIA guy or?
Yeah, the
former. Being able to break down.
Oh, here it is. All right, thank you. Proceed.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I bring you greetings from Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and United States Army Special Operations Command at Fort Bragg. I just want to thank you for being able to brief County Commissioner's Court this morning on our exercise, Jade Helm, which is a realistic military training that we look to execute between July and September this year between Tom Green and Slagger County down here. It'll actually be conducted throughout the state of Texas. My name's Tom Mead. I am a retired Special Forces senior non-commissioned officer. Currently, I'm a contractor working for United States Army Special Operations Command as an operations planner and an exercise developer specifically for Jade Helm. With me today, I have Master Sergeant Tim Robinson, who is an active duty Green Beret with 3rd Special Forces Group, who's assisting us in development and exercise. Tim's one of those guys that goes back and forth between Iraq, Afghanistan, and the United States to defend our country. So I thank guys like that who continue to do that for us. My purpose here today is we're seeking written approval and invitation from the local officials to be able to conduct realistic military training within Tom Green County for Jade Helm 15. Just to give you a little bit of background, and I know that each one of the commissioners has a copy of our briefing, and I've had the opportunity.
Now you're really, really quiet.
What?
You're very, very quiet now.
Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't by the mic. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. So anyway, that was what he was talking about that he gave to the other people for them to see the briefing. Like, that's a PDF file that you can find online. Just type Jade Helm 15 PDF. And I will be showing that in this presentation later.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that before we continue. And anything you want to say, Haplo, just let me know, and I'll pause it and go on.
No, go ahead. I will listen to this guy.
You know. What? What'd you say?
Oh, I said, go ahead. We'll just listen to the guy.
Okay.
Opportunity as of recently to meet with Commissioner Ford and with the judge and kind of talk a little bit. And we've also met with Sheriff Jones and also Chief Deputy Pierce about this exercise as well. So just to kind of give you a background of what realistic military training is and what Special Operations Command down in Tampa, Florida, and United States Army Special Operations Command at Fort Bragg defines as realistic.
Put the microphone back to your mouth.
Yesterday, and found out there was a woman that was found in a Walmart in Tampa, Florida.
Oh, dude, here you go.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't hear that. Anyway, I was doing some research yesterday and found out that there's a woman that was found in an SUV dead in a Walmart parking lot in Tampa, Florida. So keep that in mind that he's talking about these locations where they go and the situations that have occurred in these locations, especially with Walmarts.
Military training is any training that we conduct off of a federally owned installation. So when we're out in the public, for example, in Tom Green County, that is part of our realistic military training. We have a process that was designed by General Votel's staff that ensures that we do proper coordination between the Department of Defense and the local officials. Some of the things that we put in place in this process, obviously, is briefing the county commissioners And any municipality that we work in, so if we work inside of a city, we also brief the city council and get their approval to be able to work in that. One of the most important things that we do is we coordinate with all law enforcement. We make sure that the law enforcement is aware of everything that we're doing, every activity that is going on. We will coordinate with them prior to that.
Anybody have anything to say about that?
No, it sounds like little counties selling their people out one county at a time.
No, I'm good. Do we want to? How much more of this do we want?
I think we got the gist of it. If you guys want to play some more.
So the next thing is what was this woman that you're talking about?
Right, there is some sort of Walmart situation that had been happening. I'll go into that and just show my information.
Yeah, I heard about that yesterday.
So far, I got Walmart comes out of Arkansas, where Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton are from. Hillary Clinton is on the board of Walmart, according to NNDB.com.
She was on the board. She was on
a lot of different boards and things.
Harvard. She used to be a high-end member. She was in control of some aspect of the investors and whatnot in Walmart. And she got out of that to play the game. And the idea is that maybe she got back into it with Walmart. So
it's supposedly a great place for a detention center to detain people. There's usually a railroad that's close by. I was looking into TMR's information, and he actually noticed that it was close to military bases.
Yeah.
So not that far.
It does make sense in a way. The one thing I've been noticing is the one that everybody will know that's been happening last year, McDonald's across the nation closed 350 locations quietly without letting anybody know. They've been closing down their McDonald's locations and just shutting them down. There are other companies that it is kind of, the connections have been made to the Defense Department, Pentagon, and places like McDonald's and places like Walmart and whatnot. Some kind of integral, kind of network going on there. But that being said, there are other places, and I don't remember them off the top of my head, but they're quietly shutting things down. And this year, they've already, in the first quarter of this year, have shut down another 350. And they're going to shut down more all the way, and they want to shut it down as many as they possibly can all the way up until September. And there are other companies with this deadline of September to shut down their businesses. it's like something is going to happen. They're getting prepared for it. They're quietly backing out of their stuff. And it's kind of like, let's all pull out. Let's get our stuff out. Let's close this stuff down. And it's very curious because Walmart is following the same pattern. We know about Walmart. We know about McDonald's now. And I probably should look up the other list. That probably would be helpful. But anybody could really look it up. It's very strange. And September seems to be a very favorite month of 2015 right now. And in my mind, for the past couple years, I've wondered about 2015 because I kept hearing about 2015, and then and last year started hearing about September 23rd, 22nd, 24th. Very, very popular number of September. And I'm not sure anymore. What's happening? Why are all these people going underground?
Why have they stolen trillions of dollars from people, not only here in the United States, but around the world, these banksters, and why have they built these giant cities underground, and why are they starting to fill them up with people and making a big drive to get more food in there?
It happens every time there's a deterioration in modern civilization that's ruled by an oligarchy. Typically starts out with a financial crash.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so they do that because that's what they can control, you know? And then what ultimately comes out of that is a type of oppression, like overreaching, you know, like expressions of violence against their own people.
My conjecture is that they have been following Albert Pike's outline on how to achieve their goal for a new world order. World War One, World War Two, and then conflict turned the Christians and the Muslims and the Jews against each other, which they have done quite well, thank you. And here in the States and in other countries, unleash the, and this is, I believe, Albert Pike's close to exact words, the nihilists and the anarchists out onto the people. There have been clamoring and going around in the prisons as well that there has been talk that's leaked out, that there's been talk around somewhere around September. If all goes well, is what's been said, they will release prisoners just like that and tell them they can go.
That's it. Why do you think Albert Pike is right, because he was 33 degree Mason that like they exonerate, especially over here in Sacramento.
If reading history and seeing history and what's already happened, and then you read the morals and dogma and the layout that Albert Pike has, it is almost identical to our history. It's like this is the playbook they're following. And if you look and you see what these elitists, these banksters, these occultists, these secret society people, whatever you would like to call them, they are following Albert Pike's playbook. And what we're seeing is the next step in Albert Pike's playbook. And I believe that's what they're getting prepared for right now. They're testing the waters. It's testing, 1, 2, 3. Let's see how this goes. Let's get this ramped up because we need to get into the next phase of our operation to get our to achieve our goal. And I think that's what we're seeing now.
Hey, I want to take this time to welcome Mike. Welcome on in, man.
Thank you.
Any thoughts, bro?
Any thoughts?
Right now, I'm just my focus is trying to establish a connection between all of us who actually care about what's going on, because if we wait too late, we won't be able to share this information, and I wish there was some type of national point or plan that all of us really care and are genuine that we will have, so we can go and find each other, because we won't be able to rely on the masses and others. We are going to need each other.
Like a defense plan?
A defense plan as well as just a rendezvous. I mean, think about it. If you're in one city and I'm in another city and 20 of us are in different cities, imagine if just the 20 of us can come together and survive that way, bring all our resources and training together.
I concur.
Like what they call a civil war type scenario, but it'll be people that you know that live on your streets. You know, you might have driven through that town before. They're going to be people who, like, they're on different sides of this whole thing. If militaries start coming through our neighborhoods, you know, you're going to see, like, gangsters and, you know, every kind of thuggish person who wants to take advantage of this violent situation and just create more violence from it than, you know.
The Dakotas, Northern Idaho, Montana, and getting out into the middle of nowhere, and if there were a group of people that all had a plan and everybody bring their piece to the table, I can bring my knowledge of how to survive, build things from nothing, hunt, trap, snares, making things, bows, arrows. It's pretty easy. You know, and everybody kind of pitches together, could put something up quite nicely out and literally away from it all to gain a game plan and start actually being able to figure out what to do next instead of just be one lone person like Mad Max walking down the empty highway.
And that's what I'm saying. There would be unity in numbers, but if the common goal of what the collective thinking was strictly about, like you said, a village, a small village where everyone brings something different and we combine those and teach and share one another, that would be much better. Like I said, a group of 20 would be better than one.
Yep.
And I do defense in particular. I, you know, understand weapons and arts. And I have some outdoor techniques, but I bring defense to the table, teach people how to defend themselves, sticks, knives. You know, that's the part of my pie. You know, I know how to prevent things. And, you know, I'm just, you know, into martial science, so to say.
Hmm.
Yeah. It's a strategy, and you'll see people adopting all kinds of different strategies. Like if there are protesters or people getting shot at in the street, you're going to see people coming out of their houses and helping these people, these citizens who are protesting. And it's going to be, if it's a war like that, it's going to eventually become a war for the hearts and minds of the people on either sides of these things.
I think it already is a war for the hearts and the minds. Military. It has been for a long time. And I think we're just seeing it's coming to a head, the fruition, and it's coming to fruition, and they're like I said, they're testing. They're testing the waters to see when they can actually do this. And I think that they're really, really close because they want to do this. They are so in a hurry to get this done. I do believe that there are other things involved. There are things that on Mount Graham in Arizona, the Catholic Church has planted a huge observatory and sunk billions into this, and they have got giant telescopes specifically designed to see things coming into the solar system that you couldn't see if it were for a regular telescope. They're infrared. Their infrared telescope is alarmingly called Lucifer, and they have been glued to it for the past year and a half, and there have been clamorings coming out of this place, and the information coming out of the church that's being leaked out is that there is something coming. They know it and they're watching it. Nobody knows exactly what it is. I think only a few handfuls of people know what it is or have the idea of what it is. There is something heading into our solar system. There's something coming, and I'm watching all of these rich people with their little rat holes they dug out for themselves getting prepared to go in there, and a lot of them are already there. All this stuff kind of starts coming together to make me wonder, what's really happening? What, you know, this could just, you know, all of this is starting to come together for me. All of this planning, all this preparation. What if these people knew about something 30 years ago and they had all this time to plan for it? You know, it's... You know, interesting. I can say that much.
Okay, so we lost Mike. He's gone. We were talking about, he asked, the question was, what are we going to do to come together? I don't know.
Well, first is actually pick a place on a map, put a pin in it.
Head for the hills, grab your gun, make your friends. You know.
That's pretty much it. When it comes down to survival, that's pretty much it. You know, you need to know who's with you and who's against you. The more people that you got in a common collective, and I hate to use words like collective, but in essence, there's, you know, it can be good, and you know, come together and people, you know, survive together. Harder to do wandering around on your own. That's usually how people end up dead really quick in a total anarchy situation. Like the whole entire grid shuts down over the whole world for some reason. Something happens. It was just say, for instance, just hypothetically, EMP, it gets blown up in the stratosphere above the United States, and the whole entire grid goes down. It's estimated it would take less than 24 hours for a complete and total anarchy to break out, and the whole civilization would just completely collapse because people are so attached to their electronic devices and so dependent on them, they wouldn't have any idea what to do without them, and it would just, things would melt down quite quickly, and then the predators immediately start coming out. The ones that want to take everything you've got and kill anybody that gets in their way to gain as much as they can as quickly as possible so they can be the king of the hill in whatever place they're at. And that's the situation. There'll be a lot of dead bodies all over the place because the predators lurk in every corner.
Yeah, man. It's like the potential for oppressive rule is so there. It's so like at our doorstep. And it's just, if you try to imagine the shit that they're capable of in the future, and the technologies that they'll have, there'll be like some sort of propaganda, get a chip implanted in your brain, and you can control your computer better with your thoughts or something like that. And then, you know, they could just turn you off someday.
I think that's coming. But I think there is something coming. I guess I probably should just come out and say it. I do think that there is a good 71% chance that there may be something in coming inbound towards us in space, in our solar system, because the clamoring of astronomers, and this is, I latched on to this several years ago, about 10 years ago, there was clamoring, and I never really kept my, you know, my head about me and just monitored it like I usually do everything else. And when this year seemed to be, for the past couple years, a very, very significant year for people, and watching everything ramp up, watching all of these very wealthy people getting ready to go underground, and a lot of them have already, I'm wondering. Have they been preparing for this? This would be the perfect opportunity. If there was something coming in that could possibly cause global devastation of some sort, and they could be all safe and snug underground, they could plan for their world domination after this calamity had happened and come up above ground and already have a lot of things in place, the prison camps and everything else like that. It'd be like that freaking... whatever that movie is where they kill each other as kids and stuff. I don't even know the name of the movie. I don't watch this stuff. But, you know, the futuristic kind of stuff. You know, the perfect storm, so to speak. Something put, you know, a natural catastrophe that could happen that they could use as the catalyst, and they could get rid of a lot of people. I can imagine all the thousands, millions of people that would die if the whole entire world was completely thrown into chaos. And all of the people with all of the resources went underground and hid until, say, 1/3 of the population or more were gone. They could come up and have an easier time with the cleanup and then put their new world order together.
Hey, Anon2150 had to take off.
All right.
So he said goodbye.
Sorry.
Your thoughts. Anyway, so I just wanted to focus on this whole joint assisted for development and execution. So that's where it comes from. And this is actually the Air Force Research Laboratory Information Directorate. So it's pretty official, you know. You have all this information. Here's your what it is. Here's all the, you know, here you go. Here's the actual information. Oh, we got it. So it says, Joint Assistance for Development and Execution is a knowledge-based mixed initiative system that supports force, deployment, planning, and management. Jade uses case-based and generative planning methods to support the development of large-scale complex deployment plans in minimal time. Jade incorporates the technology of three tools, Prodigy Analogy, a combined case-based generative planner developed by Carnegie Mellon University. Force management and analysis tool that supports case-based force deployment and planning development by BBN Technologies and Parca, a highly indexed knowledge-based management system developed by the University of Maryland. And as Jade, military planner can build a preliminary force development plan, including the time phase force deployment data, TPFDD, in less than 1 hour. This speed plan construction is possible because Jade supports the rapid retrieval and reuse of previous plan elements for the use of the development of new plans. In addition, Jade employs an easy-to-use map-oriented drag-and-drop interface where force modules from previous plans whose force capabilities and composition match the requirements of the current situation can be dragged from the case library and dropped into the geographic destination. Plan modification and adaption is supported through remindings, e.g. each time that a force module is created or copied into a plan. TPFDD, the user is automatically reminded of the need for the geographical changes. So there you go. So that like, explains basically the computer system they use to change.
Yeah, I think they call it the Beast. I think that's what they call it. It's a basically an AI that they run tactical situations or scenarios through it, and it runs through a billion different scenarios of what could possibly happen and in any case that they put in there, and it spits out the best course of action at that time, and it can do it in real time. These people are hired tacticians. They're military planners. They are professionals. What they do, and they are good with, a contingency plan. They have already got 900 contingency plans put into place. If one thing goes wrong, they already have it covered. This what these people are hired to do. That's what that just said in some technical terms. They have all of these resources, which they listed, which is the massive amount of computing ability that they have to gain the tactical ground on whoever or whatever it is that they seem hell-bent on, coming up against. So,
yeah, and
very interesting.
Me that this Baltimore thing seems connected, like they were just there ready for it to happen.
Mm-hmm. No, I think this is they're training, they're getting this ready, and something is going to happen. It's cooking. It's right now. It's so close. We just don't know because they aren't letting all this stuff. They're keeping a lot of this stuff so tight. It's a need-to-know basis, and very few people really know the absolute truth. And everybody else that doesn't need to know doesn't know, and this is how they're keeping things done. And if they have somebody that does come out, they end up mysteriously dying. There's people that have come out in the last several years trying to see, especially with astronomers. There's been many, if you look this up, astronomers have been coming out trying to say something, and they end up dying, like their car blows up. And then their whole work is discredited. They are made to look like crackpots, and they are completely buried, and media doesn't even touch them. And the underground media or the alternative media gets about 40,000 different stories to choose from about the same person, which basically it's like trying to find a needle in a stack of needles on what really the truth is. So they're keeping this very tight on what's going on. But the one thing that set me to pay attention more closely were the mass amounts of astronomers about 10 years ago that were getting knocked off left and right. It was brought to my attention, and I said, this is weird. So I started paying attention to it where I could. and what the resources I had, and that's why I say the things I say. Something's going on because these guys have been getting knocked off left and right. Now it's to the point where everybody knows that if they say something, they're going to die. You're going to die. It's a death sentence to say anything because this is so important to the people that control the wealth of this world that that nobody else is daring to say anything. So it's now left up to conjecture, speculation. We just don't know until it finally happens. And that's what they want. They want to catch everybody off guard. They want to catch people unsuspecting. That's their tactical advantage. That is the best tactical advantage, is to whatever your target is that you catch them with their pants down, so to speak. You want to catch them.
In the blue list, right?
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah, they've got people picked out. Got them already. Got their pictures, their profiles. They're ready to go. They probably even have samples of their DNA. They got everything ready. They probably have some top picks on their lists of dissidents or whoever it is that they don't want. They probably have military connection or background. Probably veterans. Veterans are usually the ones in countries that are going to have some kind of changeover. Military veterans are usually the first ones to get snatched up and disappeared, because they are the ones that will cause the most problems, because they are trained and they do know the tactics. They know what's going on, and they see the signs. So they got to get rid of the guys that know anything. So, yeah, this whole thing is, I see it coming to fruition. It's coming. And we just don't know exactly what it is. Yeah, I can do as much digging as I can with what I've got, but I don't have a lot to work with, because it is a need to know. And when it's a need to know, you just never will know.
Right. We can only speculate based on the information given and
that's right.
Data that's out there that they put in front of us.
That's right, and that could be a ruse. Let's just be serious about this. It could be a ruse. The whole thing could be a ruse. It could be a setup for something else entirely, to throw anybody that would be interested, people like you and I, anybody, completely throw them off track for some other purpose. It always is that possibility. Nothing is rock solid when it comes to liars.
Well, I just wanted to go into a little bit of these articles I've come through. This one here is, you know, from The Last Great Stand, and it's the proof the military is transitioning from drills, and this was April 4th. So mm-hmm. You know how this kind of set it up ahead of time before essentially the thing in Baltimore happened.
Baltimore is a big fizzle. That one didn't work out. It really, and this one was kept very quiet. But faces that were in Ferguson, were caught in Ferguson on video devices, pictures taken, videos taken of some of the key rioters and people that were the protesters that were causing all the problems, just happened to be in Baltimore too, amazingly enough. And when that information came out, it's almost like the whole thing just turned into there's 6 protesters and 500 cops. It's not anything. It's fizzled out because people realized what's going on. That they are busing people in. They're probably paid actors, and they're just doing it again. They're trying to start social, they're trying to disrupt society anywhere they can go, and they just want to find the one thing that's going to ignite the flames that will fire across the country. Ferguson did a pretty good job, as people were protesting about it all over the country in small pockets.
Well, we're doing that with the this new one, the one with the Freddie Gray. I mean, yeah, Freddie Gray.
Yeah, but this one isn't working as well. It's not erupting all over. I mean, there were people in Berkeley, New York, opposite sides of the country, protesting over the Ferguson incident. And I think that they're taking a horrible incident, making a mockery of it, and the corporate-owned media is bringing in paid and hired actors to come in and fan the flames of a situation so they can get their cameras in there and get the American people that are stupid enough to think that they're actually being told the truth on these channels to go, oh no, the sky's falling. It's like Chicken Little. And Chicken Little is our DOD. It's our Homeland Security, NSA, CIA, all of the other freaking letters. That's Chicken Little, and that's what they're doing now. They're trying to tell everybody the sky's falling. They're trying to find the one thing that'll get at least, all you need is 10% of the country to completely fall apart, and you've got them. And they haven't been able to get to that 10% yet. And I can see it plain as day that this is being worked by a hidden entity, a hidden hand, trying to make something ignite. They want to light the fuse to start civil unrest across the nation. And they're going to keep trying. You're going to see this happen all over the place until they finally find the right fuse to light that's going to ignite the rest of the fuses. So they can call in and maybe pull off their martial law earlier than what they think they want to do. I think their deadline is somewhere at the end of 2015.
Yeah, that's what it seems like. And, you know, that seems to be set up, like, in a way to keep Obama in the office, like, indefinitely. You know,
oh, yeah.
Have three states of emergency over separate areas, and they're declared, like, you know, curfew or martial law, in a sense, then they can put a state of emergency on the whole entire of the United States and essentially create a curfew indefinitely until they decide to take it off.
Now, when that happens, I would make the suggestion to anybody that's hearing this, grab your fucking shit, your packs, your gear, and quietly leave in the middle of the night, avoiding any authority figures, and get yourself out into the middle of nowhere. If you don't know how to survive, then hole up in your house, do whatever you got to do, but the best course of action would be to bug out. Get out, because something is very unfortunate is going to happen to people that stick around in their homes where they can be gotten to.
Yeah. Agreed there. So I wanted to read this real fast. The use of Green Berets, Navy SEALs, and Special Operations Command Force speaks to the unconventional composition of the overall makeup of this group. Among the uses of these three Special Operations groups include infrastructure raids, assassination of key enemy personnel, reconnaissance, and extraction of key enemy personnel enemy personnel for detention and or intelligence gathering. It is the latter duty that has me concerned, and this is the person who wrote this, as there has been much discussion over the execution of a red list, and that's what we were discussing earlier, mm-hmm. in which key resistant figures would be kidnapped and dealt with in advance of the implementation of martial law. A detailed analysis of language of Jade Helm has convinced me that we are looking at the implementation of the snatch and grab key resistance figures to the coming martial law. My sources have told me that past drills of this nature, red list, extraction troops are helicoptered in the early morning hours, 3 a.m., land, offload personnel, and extract the indeed intended targets SWAT team style.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I think there's people that have they've been profiling people. That's what all this social media has been letting them do. They've been profiling people. They have caught anything they can glean, and they run it through it's artificial intelligence. It's a thinking machine, and it spits out names of people that the machine thinks would be good candidates to rise up and have people follow them. Good leaders, you know, John Connors, that type of thing, you know, if movie references, those types of people, they have them labeled, and they have a list. I'm fairly certain of this, and at the right time, when they can pull it off, they are going to find them. They're going to round them up. Religious leaders, especially, those religious leaders are very influential, and they will round them up. And I don't think it's going to be interrogation. They make it sound so nice, but what I hear in there is a room with a drain in the middle of it and them on their knees and a bullet in the back of their head and then a shallow grave and like a body dump situation, you know, wherever they do it, or a cremation. But that's what it sounds like to me, because if they can get rid of the people with the even the potential to lead an uprising, they're all the more for their control.
Yeah, exactly. And let me read this real fast. It says, this is from a civilian research project paper from the U.S. Army Special Operations Forces. It states, the human domain is the totality of the physical, cultural, and social environments that influence human to the extent that success of any military operation or campaign depends on the application of unique capabilities that are designed to fight and win population-centric conflicts. It is a critical and complementary concept to the recognized domains of land, air, maritime, space, and cyberspace.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, what's up, Robert? Are you there?
Hello.
Doing some shit, getting some errands done. What do you
got? There you are.
I got it. Is it a shitty connection or what?
Kinda. You got your video on.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'll cut the video out. It might improve the view.
Yeah, it's probably, yeah, when I put my video on, it just kills my bandwidth.
Yeah, and Google's not even working when the bandwidth's good.
Yeah, tell me about it. You want to give them an update of what we were talking about, or you want me to?
You go ahead. You know, you have a good spin on it.
Now, the initial was the Jade Helm 15, the closing of the Walmart.
I got to kind of go. If you guys are still on when I get back.
Sure.
Oh, okay, for sure.
Yeah, I gotta go and I gotta go get transmission fluid and change my transmission fluid out because my girl's hurting here. My car's like, see you guys.
Bye.
For sure, man. Take care of
I'll try and find you when I get back.
All right.
Sounds good. All right, let's see. So there was another thing I wanted to show. I got a bunch of articles, so I'm just kind of going down each one. And, okay, so this one's what would happen if martial law was declared in America, and this was back in April 9th.
Mm-hmm.
So you got, in recent weeks, there has been a lot of concern that the Jade Helm Week military exercise on U.S. soil is known as Jade Helm, is actually a dress rehearsal for the imposition of martial law in this country. One of the reasons...
Can I cut in real quick? Who wrote that article you're reading right now?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Well, who wrote it? I'm just asking, yeah.
Journal. Michael Snyder.
Okay, I that one sounded familiar. I just wanted to see.
You know, don't take this into consideration. I always look at all types of articles and whatnot. Hmm. I did notice over here, you have the red and black hexagons.
Mm-hmm.
So this could be Saturn-influenced stuff.
Oh, but I think it ultimately is.
But it's good to see what they're trying to push on us.
Yep.
And their perspective of what they think we should think.
Yeah, a lot of times you can. You're right. And since you mentioned that before you go back into the article... Yeah. When reading an article, the first thing I see is the gangland graffiti, that the signs and the symbols that are used by entities, individual riders. A lot of times, you know, they really do see the general populace of any region in the world as being a bunch of cows that just don't have a clue. And a few scant people amongst the population actually know how to determine or decipher their lingo, their symbol, their symbology. And those are the things I look for. When I start seeing cubes and hexagons, anything like the CERN symbol, you know, the 666 and things like that, I kind of have a good idea what I'm getting from them.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, it's not for us anyway. It's for them.
Exactly. You start finding, like, stuff that... It's the things that don't make sense in an article when you got a whole bunch of gangland signatures all over it and their symbology usually is information for somebody else that they know all too well what it means, but the regular average Joe on the street doesn't.
Exactly. So to continue, one of the reasons for this high level of concern is that we have seen a dramatic increase in the number of urban warfare exercises conducted by the U.S. military in major U.S. cities over the past decade, including exercises where dissidents are hunted down, arrested, and hauled away. As our world becomes increasingly unstable, and as our society rapidly decays from within, many believe that it's the only matter of time before the executive branch will have sufficient excuse to use the extensive martial law powers that it has been accumulating since 9/11. When that day arrives, what will our nation look like? What would actually happen if martial law was declared in America? Well, the first thing that you need to know is that U.S. Constitution would be suspended. In other words, you would suddenly have no rights at all. There would be no freedom of speech, no freedom of the press, no freedom of assembly, and you could be arrested at any time for any reason whatsoever. For the duration of the emergency, the military would be in control. There would be troops in the streets, a curfew would almost certainly be imposed, and armed checkpoints would be set up. If the emergency lasted long enough, we would probably see authorities go house to house confiscating firearms, ammunition, and food supplies. And perhaps most troubling of all, dissidents and subversives would likely be rounded up and imprisoned. So there you go. I'm going to go into another article. Do you have anything to add to that?
Nope, that sounds about right. I think they pretty much summed that one up.
Bow, bow, bow.
Or he, I should say.
This one's about the governor ordering Texas Guard to military exercise over fears of federal takeover. People have been going up in arms about this one, too, lately. I've been hearing it around my area. Governor Greg Abbott ordered Texas Guard to monitor federal military exercises in Texas after some citizens have lit up the internet saying the maneuvers are actually the prelude to martial law. The operation causing rampant suspicion in this new kind of exercise involving the elite teams such as the SEALs and Green Berets from our four military branches training over several states from July 15th to September 15th. Called Jade Helm 15, the exercise is one of the largest training operations done by the military in response to what is called the evolving nature of warfare. About 1,200 special operative personnel will be involved and move covertly among the public. They will use military equipment to travel between seven southwestern states from Texas to California. On Monday, command spokesman Lieutenant Colonel Mark Lastoria attended a Bastrop County Commissioner's Court meeting to answer community questions and was met with hostile fire. The story, in response to some of the questions from the 150 who attended, sought to dispel fears that foreign fighters from the Islamic State were being brought in or that Texans' guns would be confiscated, according to a report in the Austin American-Statesman. He was forced to rebuke that martial law was underfoot and said misinformation has been spread by those with a personal agenda. You know, side note, though, we do have martial law happened already in Baltimore.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Kind of.
There's still things that have not been undone since 9/11 that technically the president can act on. At any moment right now, the call to suspend the Constitution could be made, even now. But I think it's just like everything else, taking it in increments, slowly, like the frog in the frying pan. You turn the frying pan on, heat up the hot, throw a frog in, it's going to jump out. But if you put that frog in there and it just sits in there while it's cold and you turn the heat on and slowly turn the heat up, that frog's going to sit there and just cook to death. That's how they like to do things, because they see how society works. They've done their homework.
And then this spa, like, turns up more as you're, like, falling asleep.
That's right, and that's what we're watching. It's
frying.
We're the society. We've got people out here going, hey, there's a problem. There's a problem going on here. And everybody else is going, yeah, whatever. There's morons saying that things are, you know, the heat's turning up. And these people don't realize that they're cooking in the, cooking in the frying pan.
That's weird. I can't get this bigger. Well, I wanted to read this little Governor Greg Abbott thing. It's very small. You can't really see it very well, but it says, to address the concerns of Texas citizens to ensure that Texas communities remain safe, secure, and informed about military procedures occurring in their vicinity. I am directing the Texas State Guard to monitor Operation Jade Helm 15 during the operation's 8-week training period from July 2015 to September 2015. I expect to receive regular updates on the progress and safety of the operation. During the training operation, it is important that Texans know their safety. Constitutional rights, private property rights, and civil liberties will not be infringed. By monitoring the operation on a continual basis, the State Guard will facilitate communications between my office and the commanders of the operation to ensure that the adequate measures are in place to protect Texans. U.S. Special Operations Command has assured Texas that each location selected for training exercise will pose no risk to residents or property, and that they will coordinate with local residents via I don't know what that says, and written communication. Directing the State Guard to monitor the operation will allow Texas to be informed of the details of military personnel movements and training exercise schedules, and it will give us the ability to quickly and effectively communicate with local communities, law enforcement, public safety personnel, and citizens. The action I take today comes with the recognition of Texas' long history of supporting all military forces and proud tradition of training, deploying and supporting our active troops and returning veterans. As governor, I have the utmost respect for the deep patriotism of the brave military men and women who put their lives on the line to fight for and defend our freedom. I remain certain that our military members will keep America the first and strongest nation in the world has ever known. All right, so you have anything to add to that?
Nope.
All right, I'll go on to the next article I have. This one has to do with a Walmart connection to the Red Chinese secret police. Have you heard about this?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So you know. So to understand Walmart, you have to have a handle on Arkansas and figure out Arkansas. You have to be knowledgeable of Rockefellers, and to fathom the Red Chinese police, you have to, or secret police, you have to know a lot about the richest family in the world, and that's, of course, the Rockefellers. So to begin, the Rockefellers are like to own and operate entire states with sizable geography and good nature assets and relatively small population. That way, if need be, to win a so-called election, they could more or less find it cheap to buy all the votes they may need to install their people. West Virginia is such a state. Like an ancient colossus of Rhodes, astride an entrance to harbor, the Rockefellers have a foot on both sides. On occasion, they pretend to be Democrats, other times as Republicans. They have installed as U.S. Senator John D. Rockefeller IV, great-grandson of John D. Rockefeller, founder of the bloody and infamous Standard Oil Trust, broken up by a U.S. Supreme Court decree in 1911, the Standard of Oil Trust, changing its name slightly to Fool Novices, is back together again. Historically, Standard Oil would be bombed their own obsolete plants to blame onto a competitor, thereby gaining support and strangling competition. This goes on. There's something I wanted to explain about the Walmart stuff. Another Rockefeller owned and operated state is Arkansas. Sizable land, small population, you cannot be so much as a successful dog catcher there without blessings of the Rockefeller. Several terms before Clinton, with Winthrop Rockefeller was governor, our interviews with middle-level members of the Rockefeller family convince us his proper name should be William Rockefeller Clinton. We feel certain from all we know that Sludge Willie is the illegitimate great-grandson of the unsmiling Rockefeller patriarch. So yeah, I didn't know about that one, but you know, that's an interesting observation. Do you know about that, the connection to Rockefeller and Clinton?
Oh yeah. Okay. Oh yeah, definitely.
So then goes down, talks about
it the, actually in that article, I will have to say that it does say that the Rockefeller family is one of the richest families or wealthiest families in the world. That's not true. The Windsors and the Rothschilds. The Rothschilds are probably the wealthiest family. They believe that everything, you follow the money, it's always able to be followed. They're about $500 trillion net worth, the Rothschilds. The Windsor family, which would be the royal family of the United Kingdom, are worth about $30 trillion that can be seen on the surface, and guesstimating probably another $100 trillion hidden away, and probably because they own lots of land all over the world.
In the dark. You don't seem to come across them in these reports.
Nope. They do not. They have so much money, they do not get spoken of. The Rockefellers are probably worth about $20 trillion. So the Rockefellers work for the Rothschilds, basically. If you follow the history of it, the ancestors of the Rockefellers actually were in with the Rothschilds bankers, and they sent over Rockefeller and established him in the United States, I think in the early 19th century when this happened, and the Rockefeller family has been here ever since. They basically are financially backed and are just another arm of the Rothschild family.
So you got Walmart and J.B. Hunt Transport Services. Where did the funding come from in the 1980s for them to get so big? If you think they spread out simply because they are clever, then you're a firm believer in fairy tales. In simple terms, the backward state of Arkansas, controlled by the Rockefellers, with Rockefeller agent calling himself Bill Clinton, became the shuttle point for the Red Chinese in America. When it comes to evidence, you have to recognize the circumstantial proof can be as powerful as paper records. How about those murder cases and sentenced to death penalties, not by way of eyewitnesses, but only circumstantial proof, not documents? Now, side note, this actual article thing comes from Sherman H. Schulnick, but it was actually... and written 8-2701, but then it was put out here on 2012, March 11th,
mm-hmm.
Unveiled Mine Archive. So I just wanted to let people know that that's where this came from. And it's an old, like, article brought back.
Yep.
Because
it's... Oh, go ahead.
What's up?
Oh, the connections that I made are with the Rothschilds, the Windsors, and the Rockefellers is actually historically documented. It is in history books. It's there to be found. You have to dig for it, and it is able to be found. I guess I could put something together, but I don't have a lot of time since I work all the time. But
World Bank. A woman that worked in the World Bank, and I have to look her name up. That basically, that's where I got a lot of this. She kind of outed a lot of things several years ago about what was going on within the World Bank, and the World Bank being attached to the main central bank out of the city of London. They literally were ciphering trillions of dollars from the American people. And she put a lot of this stuff together and confirmed a lot of things that people had read and understood from history. But then she said, no, this is still going on today. And I could look her up, actually. But it's out there. I mean, it's all there. I mean, it's at the fingertips to be found. Information is flying right now. Might as well grab it when you can. So anyway, go ahead.
Okay, so basically, you know, then we have the closing Walmart scenarios that show up, and that's why I was talking about the Chinese, the Red Chinese secret police thing, because it seems to be connected to this whole Walmart closure in a way.
Yeah.
So what does it say? It says Walmart workers are fighting back against the retailer's decision last week, closed 5 stores in 4 states for what the company says are plumbing repairs. Workers at the company's Pico Rivera, California, who are associated with our Walmart, a group that advocates for better pay, says the closings are retaliatory. They filed a charge with the National Labor Relations Board on Monday, claiming that the termination of more than 500 employees at the Pico Rivera Walmart constituted an unfair labor practice. Last week, the retail giant, which employs 1.3 million workers in the United States, temporarily closed 5 stores, 2 in Texas and one each in California, Florida, and Oklahoma, for 6 months of plumbing repairs. Now, side note, 6 months would lead directly associated with the Jade Helm procedure. If you like back it up, you know, like add the 6 months to where we are now when it closed. You see what I'm saying? July to September.
Yep.
So the store closed at 7 p.m. on April 13th, which gave workers just a few hours notice that they were losing their jobs. The company provided 2 months of paid leave for both full-time and part-time workers. Employees could try to transfer a different Walmart location during that time. Full-time workers who failed to find another Walmart job are eligible for severance. There you go. Starting June 19, but part-time workers aren't entitled to that benefit. A Walmart spokesperson, man, told Fortune on Friday that deciding to close the store is not a decision we make lightly, but after careful consideration, we felt it was necessary to make these repairs so we can better serve our customers and the community in the long run. He said Walmart regularly assesses the conditions of stores and that due to ongoing plumbing issues that will require extensive repairs, the company would need temporarily close the 5 stores, while Walmart says it intends to reopen them when the plumbing issues are resolved. So that's kind of interesting. They do tend to reopen them. So what are they going to hire all new people then? How's that going to
work? They'll probably bring back the other people. The question I have is that the Walmart might be just coincidental. It could be that they had a... And these Walmarts, from what I understand, they have... I think it was a national-wide contractor for plumbing that did the work in all of these stores at the time that they were being developed and they were being built. There could be a serious defect somewhere, and they have to go in and rip up the floors to get to the pipes and things that are maybe under concrete to maybe fix a defect.
Well,
something like that. It could be legit, too. You always have to look at it that way, too.
There's something strange happening associated with this Walmart thing, because people have snuck in and, you know, like got footage, and if you look at it, you can see that the area they closed down, they didn't like they're not using it in a sense. They're just closing it off to the public.
Mm-hmm.
So that seems like a little suspicious to me.
Well, and one thing I understand about corporate scenarios is they do everything, they like to do everything at the same time in order, and it could very well be that they have got things closed off and they're getting ready to have all their guys come out and do whatever needs to be done. Then again, they could be closing it down, having a whole bunch of people working for the Homeland Security coming in ready to build cages inside. We don't know. But I always have to look at some things could be, taken the wrong way, and something happened at the right time to make it look like something. And it is not beyond people in high places to use situations such as that to take the focus away from things as well.
Right.
You know, tactically thinking people, people that have been trained in that thought process, know to use anything and everything that comes into their path as a tactical advantage. And that is how it works. You can use anything and everything when you have an objective, your goal, and you're trying to get to it. Instead of looking at everything as a hindrance, if your mindset is in the way that a lot of these people are trained to think, you will see everything as a tactical advantage because it can be used thusly. And that's the difference between success and failure. Instead of looking at things as a stumbling block, you say, well, we can do this and turn it into something else to make it an advantage in our favor.
Exactly. And here's another one from News 10. It says, Brandon, Florida, it's not just one, but 5 Walmarts closed across the United States are closing their doors due to plumbing problems that in some cases will take 4 to 6 months to repair. Those closings include locations in Livingston and Midland, Texas, Tulsa, Oklahoma, near Los Angeles. And I'm documenting all of these different closing places and how they relate to the deaths that are occurring as well at these Walmarts. Mm-hmm. For the Brandon Walmart, I talked to Hillsborough County and Walmart to get answers about why these plumbing repairs will take so long and whether the issues are connected. But local customers are already skeptical. Why is plumbing, why is it just plumbing problems? It's going to take them 6 months to fix up the store, asked customer John Mambry, or Mambrel. After a deluge of shoppers lined up for hours to get deals Monday, I just tried to go into the door and it's like, it's closed, said Walmart shopper Jody White. Hundreds were turned away in the Walmart superstore on East Brandon Tuesday, where they found doors shut and locked in the pharmacy guarded by security. Walmart spokesperson released a statement Tuesday on the closure. As part of an effort to ensure all of the stores are fully serving the needs of our customers, we regularly assess the conditions of our stores. Due to ongoing plumbing issues that will require extensive repairs, we are temporarily closing the Rico Brandon store. We will immediately begin the process to address these issues and intend to reopen the store as soon as all the plumbing issues are resolved. Deciding to close the store is not a decision we make lightly, but after careful consideration, we felt it necessary to make these repairs so we can better serve our customers and the community in the long run. So yeah, that's just basic. So the News 10 goes on, and officials say they have no record of any code or permit violation in the Brandon location. When 10 was at the Walmart Tuesday, there were no marked skeptic trucks or plumbing vehicles in the lot. So taking that into consideration, it seems that basically they're setting up a front in a way. Something like, you can do this area, but you can't go to this area because that area is only, for special. So you'd have to know people in order to get into that area. he was saying.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of a front, generally.
Yeah, there's so many possibilities right now. And everything is conjecture. Nothing is rock solid because the people that are trained and are involved in this type of in these types of situations know what they're doing. They're seasoned veterans in this type of thing. They have had lots of practice with social engineering, and they know exactly what buttons to push and which direction to lead a populace in to keep them off the mark. Because they've had a lot of foul-ups. In the beginning stages of the Vietnam War, actually through the entirety of the Vietnam War, we had Walter Cronkite, and we had people with video cameras over there videotaping everything and bringing it back and showing it on the nightly news with Walter Cronkite basically reading everything that was written by their field reporter with no editing. And the CIA and other government agencies, the DOD, all of these agencies looked at this and went, shit. They're giving up the game. They learned from their mistakes, and what we're seeing is the evolution of social engineering at its best. And add the technology we've got, the green screening, all of the things, they can make anything into anything and get anybody to believe it. I mean, if we see this with 9/11, they've got an entire world believing that a couple bumbling morons jumped up on an airplane with a box cutter and crashed them into some buildings and brought two buildings down with burning fuel that somehow burnt through solid steel beams, which would never happen. But yet they convinced people of this crazy idea, and it still flies to this day.
Building 7.
They just completely let that one go. Most Let's not even mention
remember
it.
Remember the Building 7.
Yeah, but the biggest question I had when the first thing was happening was that right when it was happening, it seemed like there was news media cameras already set up and waiting. They were aimed at the towers in strategic locations to catch all points of view from around those buildings several blocks out. And I'm going, wait a minute. Why were those cameras there? Why was CNN, it looked like it was set up. I watched it go down on TV. Huh?
There was no event that day other than that.
Exactly. There wasn't anything going on. And they had several camera angles. I sat and watched it on TV when it first, like the TV was interrupted, the show that was on, boop, it was in the middle of the day. Actually, it was probably closer to the morning, late morning, when this went down. And all of a sudden, everything that was on TV, boom. As I was sitting at, I think, a Burger King or something, they had some soaps going. And all of it was interrupted. And before even a plane had hit, there's a camera pointed at the Twin Towers. And I asked myself this, and I asked this throughout the entirety. Why in the world were there cameras aimed at this ready to go to watch these planes crash into this building? And
There was only one that we know of that caught the first one hitting, the first plane hitting.
Yeah.
And it basically was like already interviewing someone, and he kind of caught it in the corner and turned.
And then later on, I think it was the next day.
Could have been set up.
Yeah, it was brought out that BBC timestamped. It was timestamped, and there's still video footage of this, was announcing this World Trade fiasco like an hour before it happened. They had the news media set up and ready to go for their big show. I asked this question the whole entire time at the very beginning of it, all the way through until now, and I have proof that people are stupid because I have a very brilliant guy I call my dad that is stupid enough to believe that this was pulled off by people with box cutters. And I go around with him. I say, I will tell him, you are a logical thinking person. You can think cognitively, but yet you refuse
to even bother making any one move to look at any of the information because you're too afraid. And I think that's what it is. People are, at this point, too afraid to look underneath all of the crap to see that their country is not what they thought it was.
Yeah.
And that's what they have. They have this mentality. They brilliant people, professors, doctors, heart surgeons, they will buy this shit hook, line, and sinker every time. We've seen it time and time again. And we even have information that comes out with the Freedom of Information Act that says that the Gulf of Tonkin was a false flag operation and that the Vietnamese did not attack us. It is absolutely 100% proven, and they got up and read it on camera. I believe it was in Congress or whoever, wherever it was. I can't remember right off the top of my head, but they it has been stated. I think it might have been Ron Paul if I was reading this, that it was stated for fact that the Gulf of Tonkin that got us into the Vietnam War was a false flag operation to get us in the war. They had to orchestrate a false flag to get the American people swayed in their minds to agree enough to send their boys over there to die.
Yeah, and agreed. So if they did that once, why wouldn't they do it again?
Yeah, I've tried to present this information to some older people from that generation, and they still, even presented with the stamp, the seal on it that says that this is the where it came from, and that's what it is, it was released, they refuse to believe it. Because I think they're too afraid. They're so afraid their little world will come crumbling down. And that's what we're dealing with. And that is what the power they have. They know they're that stupid in their fear, that they are afraid to look beneath everything, to see the absolute truth in it. And that's what we people have called it for ever since after 9/11, waking up to the truth. The fact is that this country, what people thought it was, and people still think is not. And there's more and more people coming out now, especially with the communication abilities that we have now. This is why we're seeing the FCC taking over the internet. This is why all of a sudden now things like with the Freedom of Information Act, new information about 9/11 just got released recently, I think within the last year. And a whole bunch of new 9/11 videos popped up all over YouTube. And almost within an hour of them going on YouTube, they all got smacked down and removed. Every single last one of them. They have to control this. They have to make their move because there are people. And if enough people in this country and the world, and I think there's a lot of people in the world that have woke up, but we need about 10% of the populace in this country to wake up to the fact that our government has gone rogue and it is time to stand up and do what our Constitution says we have to do. Get those bastards out of there and take it back. Stop buying into the bullshit. We are right now, I think, at a 7%. We need another 3% to get our country back.
I've been trying to set up a thing with the local advocates here to when Jade Helm comes here, if it does or whatever, like as far as, because it's supposed to come to the lower area.
Mm-hmm.
To basically protest it. So, you know, because we protest things here all the time, and it's a way to get the people that don't even know it exists, you know, like hey, it's happening, it's here, it exists, it's real.
Yeah, people that live in the capital somewhere going, there's a capital here?
Right.
What the hell?
It's my understanding, if you listen to the presentation, he explains that something about 50 potatoes, if he needs to get 50 pounds of potatoes to his troops, he's not going to send them from Fort Bragg. He's going to have them go into town and grab them from the local stores.
Exactly.
So that sets up the idea of the Walmart.
That's true, too. It could be that as well. That's a good point.
So I wanted to lead into the dead man found in Walmart parking lot.
Was it a woman or a man?
It's a man.
Was it a man?
Well, there was a woman too, but that was a different Walmart parking lot.
Maybe people just got a little too close.
So this is Texas, Deer Park. A man was found dead Sunday evening inside a SUV in a Walmart parking lot. And this was 11 a.m. March 17th. So again, a couple days before the Baltimore thing. Mm-hmm. So the body of Harry Lee Curley was discovered in the driver's seat of the silver Dodge Durango. Curley is from Corpus Christi. Deer Park PD investigators on the scene said there didn't appear to be any foul play, but they're treating the SUV as a crime scene. Medical examiner was called to determine the cause of death. The Walmart is located on the Spencer Highway near East Boulevard. And that looks like it's it for that. So that one basically is just a short letting us know that there was a dead man at a parking lot in Walmart.
I always have to be the devil's advocate too, because some of these things can just be nice little diversions. Could be somebody decided to go fire up, go mainline some heroin and just overdosed in the parking lot too, and they just decided to say something like, "Don't tell them how it happened."
It's about the timing, though.
That's the thing. It could be perfect timing for them to use it into their advantage to draw attention to something else as well. And I'm not saying that's true, but it could be that the guy walked in there, saw something he shouldn't have, and, well, voila. He's now pushing daisies.
I wanted to bring attention to TMR's work because he's been working on this. So I grabbed his links, and I'm showing these things to you and people. So if you want to go deeper, go into TMR's work, Truth Media Revolution.
Truth Media Revolution.
Two people were found dead on a rural road behind Walmart. The bodies were found this morning in Seminole inside an SUV. See, there you have another SUV. The discovery has rocked this small town of about 7,000. Seen a few police cars driving away in that way. I was wondering what was going on, and then I see the helicopter, Mark Flory said. Flory was fishing his grandfather's pond just feet away from where the bodies were found. I have no clue of anything. We just pulled up, but heard two persons were dead, Flory said. I wasn't here at 7 a.m. when the bodies were discovered, but he saw the aftermath of the investigators gathering evidence. Officer arrived, peered inside the vehicle, found two deceased individuals, a male and a female, Jessica Brown with the Oklahoma State Bureau of Investigators said. We now know these people are 30-year-old Summer Goki and 26-year-old Joseph Bounds. The investigators are not telling us where the incident happened, but we followed these tire tracks to off Harvey Road to where it looks like the trailblazer was stuck in the mud. Injuries to the bodies indicate a homicide to us. We have no reason to believe it is anything other than a homicide at this point in time. So, don't want to go too into that, but basically what I take from that is that there's a connection, in a way, to the SUV. And, side note, I've spoke to a special ops person who ended up dead after talking to him, strangely, told me that you know, you don't have to worry about white vans, but watch out for that black SUV. Because I was like...
Oh, absolutely. They absolutely love that black unmarked vehicle.
Yes. So that was a side note, you know, because we're coming across SUVs, and that's interesting to me. Yeah. Next one. Let's see here. This one was at a Sam's Club.
Sam's Club.
By the same people that own Walmart.
Yeah.
So, it's relevant in a sense. You have Odessa. Excuse me, Odessa. An investigation is underway after a man was found Tuesday morning decomposing in the Odessa Sam's Club parking lot. The body was found by a truck driver walking by who says she smelled a foul odor coming from the truck. Police said there is no exact time frame for how long the man was in the parking lot. Investigators say it could have been weeks. Those who found him say they saw the parked truck, uh, park the truck parked there all week, but never thought anything of it until the smell was unbearable. We were on our way back from Lewes this morning and thought, golly, look at that truck. And what's that? Who says golly? And what's that leaking? Because it was wet all under. So we were all like, what's that? And the man, or said the woman who called the police, Pamela Robinson.
That would be when Southern state people say, golly.
Right. I think that's just an accentuation. Yep. That's when Robinson and her friend got a closer look at the truck and had been sitting in the parking lot with them all weekend. The windows were foggy and the moisture or whatever, and didn't want to touch it, of course. And we looked in, and he said it looked like pants with a leg. I thought it was one of those drawstring bags, said Robinson. But when the police showed up, they discovered a body. Robinson's worst case scenario. He said there is a hair in there, and I go, oh my God, there is really a body in there, said Robinson. The body was so badly decomposed that the police can't identify the man, nor can they estimate an age or really how long he had been there. It didn't happen yesterday or the day before. It happened quite a while ago. He's been dead for quite some time now, said communications officer from the Odessa Police Department, Steve Lasore. So there you have another dead person, right? I don't know. It doesn't say what he was in, just a truck, right? So that's kind of interesting.
Now, the questions I've got is, I haven't even looked at it, is the locations of these places compared to the places that are shut down. The crime rate statistics of the locations of each body, what type of things are normally to be found and what the averages are, such as finding a dead body somewhere, things of that nature. Those things all fit in. It'd be kind of like going to the south side of Chicago and saying, hey, we found a body in the alley. It might have something to do with this, which really, that's actually nothing. That's pretty easy. You find bodies in alleys all the time at the south side of Chicago. So it's...
Well, if we didn't have the Jade Helm thing connected to the Walmart thing, these wouldn't really matter.
Yeah, well, we don't know. The first thing is, we don't know if Jade Helm is actually connected to Walmart. That is still conjecture. And we don't have any rock-solid evidence. It is the conjecture.
He's going to communicate with people in Walmart because he has connections. Mm. The guy said that in his presentation.
Yeah, so...
He has connections with hospitals. So keeping that in mind, and then you have special ops scenarios happening, training operations. They're supposedly taking people, right? So, what do they do with the dead people? Are they going to drop them off at Walmarts? Is that part of the operation? Or is it mainly just to make us wonder what the fuck's going on?
It could be that. It could be... strange happenstance that somebody decided to dump their victim off in that location. So we just don't know.
What's weird is after the Walmart's closed, they're allowing pharmaceuticals to happen. You can go in and get to the pharmacy, right? But you have to be escorted by a police, like the sheriff of the area. And they're... they got the whole area cut off, where you can't go into the other area of the Walmart, but you can see behind it because someone has filmed that, and you can find that online as well. But my point being is, if there's security there now, where was the security then when these dead people were found? And why aren't they found ahead of time if there's security?
Is the question. Maybe there's security there because of the dead people being found.
That's a good question, and that has to do with the timing. It's all about the timing.
Yeah,
for instance, the body found in the parking lot is the 23rd. Or, excuse me, it says it was posted the 16th, so maybe we have to go by that.
Yeah.
And then redone.
I think we could break down all of the interesting happenstances, but I think the big, giant picture is that it looks like something is gearing up, and it has been for a while. And uh, we're a lot of people have the feeling that something major, an event, another 9/11 type situation, or something even bigger on a bigger scale, is about ready to break loose. We just don't know what, when, where, how type of scenario. So, you know, it's this is basically I hate to have to say it this way, excuse my language, but it's a mindfuck kind of situation. And it does, to me, smell of social engineering all the way through and through, that there is something going on, and this whole thing is, why would they release the information on this training? Why would they make it available for everybody to look at, and those that question everything to latch onto? Is that when this broke, it seemed like everything started buzzing, and that's all I heard was this. But then what I start doing is I start looking for anything going on besides the Jade Helm. What's going
Baltimore
on?
Baltimore is the main.
Yeah, Baltimore happens, which really didn't turn into anything. It really hasn't. Looking into it ahead.
You know, news reporting gone awry, trying to create stories out of people.
That's right, and they didn't even have anything like Ferguson to hinge anything on.
Yeah, and the only thing that came out of this situation really was the coming together of the Bloods and the Crips.
Yeah, and that's very interesting when two long-time rival gangs that have been killing each other for 30 years, maybe more, maybe 35 years, they've been arch rivals. If I remember correctly, the Bloods and the Crips did originate in Baltimore, if I remember correctly. I could be wrong, but it's one of those starting places for these gangs, are all of a sudden coming together, shaking hands and saying blue and red bandanas are now, you know, combined. These people on the street are saying something. That's another thing that I look for, too. People on the street, boots on the ground, as I call them. People that are in positions of crime, but now all of a sudden are saying, you know, whiskey, tango, foxtrot, or what, you know, WTF. And then you see strange happenstances of rival gangs for many years that have had not a problem shooting each other, coming together and being good friends. What's going on? Something is happening, and strange things are happening socially out of all of this, and it is being engineered. There is a giant machine running this, and the real question is, what is running? Like the Wizard of Oz, who is behind the curtain? Who is pulling the strings? Who is running the machine?
Right.
And why?
That's pretty much all we can, you know, go by, because mm-hmm. there's a bunch of different alignments out there, and we can, like, grab them and put them together kind of like a puzzle piece and try to fit it and see if it fits.
Yep.
That's all we can, like, really do associated with this kind of format. But what I'm trying to do is show the people how it all kind of comes together at once. Like, while we're kind of communicating with it, we're also researching it.
Yeah. Well, we got to be careful about jumping to conclusions. But I say that for anybody that's listening to this that may not, might think that people are crazy. I could say I'm not crazy, because I look at every angle. That's what I was trained to look at, and look at everything that I could possibly put together. And look outside of the box as far as I can see. And there are things happening, strange things. And since you mentioned the Bloods and the Crips, that is one thing, that one of the strangest things that I have heard in a while now. I never in my life would have thought that I would have heard the Bloods and the Crips becoming BFF.
there's an interview that I found that someone else put on I can't remember the name, but I'll find it real fast and then I'll show you. It's pretty interesting. Let me see. Because it shows... Oh, here it is. Right, so I'm just going to go to the area where it, the news report itself put this on so you can hear it and then share it.
I should probably refrain. I should say we are not crazy. Because you're not crazy either. I kind of put the I in there habitually, okay. But... I wanted to rehash that.
Can you hear this?
I shared something with you. You know, throughout the night, I've had
yes.
a people say to me...
So I'm going to put that on. Screen share it. Where is it? This one? Yeah.
I shared something with you. You know, throughout the night, I've had a number of young people say to me and stop me and say, you really need to talk to us. You really need to get our voice heard. And I said, you are absolutely right. And so we have a portion of an interview we did with some of the gang members who were attending the meeting tonight with church leaders. And here's some of what they had to say. Here's your opportunity to tell me what's going on.
We want to tell the people in the city right now, Baltimore City, that the image that they're trying to portray of the gangs in Baltimore, the BGF, Bloods, the Crips. We did not make that truce to harm cops. We did not come together against the cops. We're not about to allow y'all to paint this picture of us. We got soldiers out here right now. We dirty. You know we dirty. They threw bombs at us for trying to stop what's going on right now. Y'all not about to do that to us.
So your game plan tonight has been to stop the violence.
To stop what's going on. That's all we trying to do. We want justice for Freddie Gray. We believe in that.
What do you think when you see this happening in the streets? Businesses looted, cars on fire, police injured.
It just makes us look bad. It makes us look real bad. And it's backing up what they're saying about us. They're saying we animals and we acting like savages out here. But I also agree with I don't agree with what's going on, but I understand what's going on. You know what I'm saying? I understand why people are mad, but we got to handle things another way.
What do you think?
Me, I basically think the same thing. I mean, we've been out here all day trying to prevent people from breaking the stores. They hit us with a bomb. They burnt my shirt. They ripped it, and we were still standing right there as a whole. They heard it, but we came right back there, hold hands together, and we marched together down here. We still holding strong, and we just want them to stop hurting us so we can just live our life and keep going. We trying to help them like we helping us. Without them doing that, it's just going to make everybody angry. We don't want to be angry. So we, as a whole community, we make everybody, you know, calm everybody down because they can't calm to us because they done already hurt a lot of people, killed a lot of people for no apparent reason.
This is the Bloods right here. This Bloods. We got the Power Roos over here and we got Bloods over here. We stand as one, though. We're one right now.
This black man united. I bowled Saturday. The person went viral Saturday.
I don't matter if y'all even keep on trying to say we out here trying to shoot police. We're not trying to shoot police. We're not going to let that stop us from doing what we already originally planned to do.
So people who are watching right now, what do you want to say to them? How do you want to explain what is happening tonight?
Basically, stop believing everything you hear in the media. If you were not at that protest on the day that we protested for Freddie, you don't know what actually happened. They didn't tell y'all that when we walked past the eateries downtown that people threw beers at us. People called us names. You know, everything. They called us those things. So the protest was agitated, you know?
So you guys feel that you're getting the blame, correct?
Exactly.
For what's happening. And you're saying that...
Yes, ma'am.
That as member of the Bloods,
because we black and we have flags on, they assume that we gonna hurt somebody or do this or gonna bring the next person down. And most of us, as us older people, we bring everybody closer, make sure they got jobs, go to school on time, and all that. But they just making it seem like, oh, he's black, he got a flag on, he's doing the wrong thing, and we not doing the wrong thing. Like me, I just came home, and I'm trying to do any and everything to prevent the going back home. You know what I'm saying? I got locked up for helping a female out downtown on Baltimore Street. Her beef, I was beating up, and I stopped it. I tried to prevent it. I used self-defense, even though there's no self-defense law in there. But I still rocked out. He locked me up just because I'm me. I'm a black male. A flag.
The main thing is they've been portraying us in this way for so long. And where we are in our environment, a lot of the neighborhoods, a lot of the so-called gang members and gangbangers, that's where they come from or where they are. What we're trying, the point that we're trying to get across is that we are of a different faction. What that's going to do is it start to show people in the community that we can come together as a unit and be unified and be peaceful. There was so much stuff that was going on Saturday that got portrayed in the wrong direction or in the wrong light that for some reason, who knows, right? Why they won't paint this picture in a positive way. Like when a group of 30 Bloods walks up on a group of 30 Crips and everybody salutes and shakes hands and hugs and starts to take pictures, but then the pictures that they take, they say, oh no, now they're uniting to kill cops. Like, they won't tell you the good side of what we're really, really doing in these communities. Like, while we're out here at this church tonight.
And let's get one thing understood. Although our cause is righteous, we cannot control every person. Just because a person is a member of the Bloods or Crips, we can't control every gang in the city and say, stop this. At the end of the day, everybody has their own mind. But when we were downtown protesting, I'm going to estimate that we were about 30 people strong. Out of all the thousands of people that were down there, you mean to tell me that you guys are pointing a finger at us because we had colors on? No, we're not. We can't have that. That's not what we stand for, and that's not what we're standing for today. Justice for Freddie Gray.
Thank you so much. Well, here's an understatement. Is that not a very different perspective that you probably have ever heard? So, and you know, oftentimes we have to beg people to talk to us sometimes, particularly on nights like this. As you can see, they very, very much wanted to talk to us and very, very much wanted to share their perspective.
You know what? Download that. Do you have the ability to download videos off of YouTube?
I know how to do it. And there's a place you go and you have to set it up to do that.
Yeah, I've got the ability to do it myself. Actually, why don't you just shoot the URL to me real quick?
Okay.
I'll go download that.
Yeah,
because that might disappear real fast.
Right, that's fascinating stuff, right? And you know, that's someone Rise Together put that together. Must have saw it live and recorded it.
Recorded it, caught it. That's good. We need to keep that going. I'm going to download it, and I'm going to repost it on my my YouTube site.
Information that needs to get out there. Like,
yeah, that I think is maybe an unexpected consequence from all of this. I think this one just floored everybody, even the powers that are behind this trying to instigate this, the hidden hand, the government agents over here that are acting like civilians trying to start riots, and all of a sudden the Bloods and the Crips start uniting. I think that just floored everybody. I think I just found the linchpin that I was looking for to make sense out of why Baltimore didn't turn into a Ferguson. I think it just pretty much stymied everybody, and they went, shit! That one, that's good. That is good. I like that.
Yeah, so I thought that, you know, you'd get a kick out of that, especially what we were talking about. And yeah. I figured it should be in this broadcast, so therefore it can go along and people can see it.
That's true, too. That's good. Yeah, can you shoot me that link real quick in the little chat bar?
Oh, I did. You didn't get it?
Oh, you did? I might be looking in the wrong one.
It's in the one in the... the broadcast one in the window, the Hangouts, whatever, in the little chat bar thing on the right.
Man, yeah, I'm looking. I'm in the one where we're at. I'm not seeing it. So
at the bottom. You want me to put it in the?
Yeah, I was thinking the little chat bar.
Okay.
Now, like where you type, just post it in there. That I can grab it from there. Yeah, that's perfect.
Okay, you got it.
Yep. I don't want to lose that.
Perfect.
Wait a minute. That's actually, yep, Gangs Unite. There we go. Boom, boom, boom. Perfect. liking that. That's perfect. I'm going to be honest with you, as old as I am, and I grew up in a place where there were Bloods, Crips, Vice Lords, GDs, BDs, you name it. There are several others I could throw out there, and I was living right in the middle of it. I spent from 8 until 17 living in that, and I got a lot of friends, whatnot. I know gang mentality. I've seen it, been around it, and to see something like that happen, this is significant. This just shocked me to shocked. I never thought I'd see that. And like I said before, I think that this is an unexpected consequence out of this whole thing. I do not think anybody saw this one coming.
No.
This is amazing.
I knew that was going to happen.
Yeah, boots on the ground, though, because that gave me information I needed to know. So I'm almost wondering if this news reporter is going to have a job the next day, because this is amazing, because they just told me everything I needed to know. The stuff I was looking at, I was, people that were filming it on their phones and whatnot was what I was catching. And basically what I could pick out, I could literally maybe count 6-7 people that were being called protesters. And these gentlemen just said thousands. There was like 1,000 people out there, including themselves being maybe a group of 30 out on the street with them. And all focus went to them immediately and everything. I almost have to wonder how many people in that 1,000 were, I would just call them shills, fill-ins, paid actors.
Okay, to switch gears for a second, I wanted to show some crazy commercial I came across, like while I was like forced to watch the news, and this was in between the news. So obviously this is sponsors of the news, or I mean the other way around, the news is being sponsored by them. It's Northrop Grumman, or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was watching it, and I was like, this is a creepy commercial because of what it shows. So watch this real fast, and then we'll kind of go back and pick it apart, and then I'm going to show you, like, after I kind of researched it, what I came across, and we'll kind of go into that and how it kind of associates with the Jade Helm stuff.
At Northrop Grumman, we know in the cyber world, it's always evolving. At first, we were protecting networks. Then, we were protecting the transfer of data. And today, it's evolved to infrastructure. Finance and military missions. You're to advance the front line in the cyber battle, wherever it takes us. That's the value of performance. Northrop Grumman.
So yeah, you see that? First of all, it's got this matrix fill. It's got this, going to put you in a computer kind of thing, because everything that you see there is all computerized, like digitized.
Well, I've been noticing a lot of commercials like that.
The matrix or the being inside of a human machine thing. I don't remember.
Yep. There's a couple. There's some Samsung commercials out there that I've mulled over, and the people have sent me and things like that. And I've looked at these, and it seems like something's happening. They're gearing up, and they're telling you your world. Like one is like some new, like the Samsung Galaxy 6 or 6X or S or whatever it is. Basically, they're telling you, and there's other commercials for other devices, and they're all saying the same thing, your world. And they're telling people that their world is in that phone, in that electronic device, that you are in the matrix, basically. This is your life. This is your mind. This is everything. It's like they're gearing people up to be thinking and totally relying on their phone for everything. And I'm wondering if this is just a part of a setup to get people so reliant, even more so, geared up with advertisement to become completely reliant on their electronic device, that's how they view their world, and then for the day when it all just turns off like that, and what happens?
Yeah, and basically this portrays a oh, what's that called? The way that I don't know what I'm trying to say. It didn't have any advertisement, is what I'm trying to say. What was it advertising? There's no thing to say, go look up this, you know what I mean?
Exactly. I mean, it's just basically saying that your world is we're protecting your world, and even go so far as to say military operations.
Yeah, because if we go back, you know, at the beginning here, that's obviously the data center.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have, when you get into, when it starts turning into mechanical, and then you got, it goes into cities, right? Changes through cities into a town.
Mm-hmm.
Goes into the town, goes through the town, and then goes down into the sewer.
Yep.
Down through the sewer into the train area, or like subterranean area, into the subways, travels through the subways, right? So what is that showing us? That's showing us underground.
To me, knowing networking and wiring in large metropolitan areas especially, all of the networking for everything is going to be located in that type of place. It's being run underground in giant pipes, and all of the wiring is in the pipeline with access points every couple yards or so. They'll have access points, and it's kind of taking you through to basically how everything is networked. Everything. It's giving you the tell-all that we are monitoring everything, we are watching everything, we know everything, and they're just telling you where everything's at.
Yeah, this one really creeps me out right here, because you can see that it's like an underground place.
Mm-hmm.
Got the clocks on the wall. It's got some sort of weird thing in the middle that looks like it's got screens on it.
Yeah, that'd be the subway.
Your system situation here. Well, you just think this is a subway?
I think that's a station like spot in the subway.
Here, yeah, it's probably monitoring station.
Finance.
Didn't mean to do that.
Yeah, the stuff that's showing underground, and it could also be a
like this
server spot, because I know that New York underground, they have under the major buildings, they have deep underground, like a couple stories under, they'll have server rooms underground.
Right, I think they're talking about this area where they show is, in my opinion, is like the NSA.
It could be. Yeah, there's so many stations now. It's, I mean, like I said, everything is networked. I mean, everything. They have got, there are CCTV world. Everything is being monitored and videotaped. I mean, where I'm at, there is a camera on everything.
Okay, and out of the city, up into the clouds.
Yep. Right?
Not showing the chemtrail stuff.
Yep. Well, probably, maybe even from a satellite perspective.
Showing us that they have new technology.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think it's new. I think they're just showing us that they have it now.
They're showing us it in a subliminal way.
Yep.
Because nobody who's watching this commercial is not focused on that.
No. You know, most people actually are just droned out at this point. They don't even, I mean, you pointed out, they really don't throw out a lot of information for somebody to grasp onto, because quite honestly, this type of commercial is meant more for people in the IT world.
Yeah, exactly. Now, what I noticed is this, I understand unmanned systems, I understand logistics, I understand cyber. I didn't know what C4ISR was, so I looked it up.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what I came across. It's command and control, RSTA, STA, sniper, surveillance and target acquisition, artillery STA, military intelligence, information warfare.
Mm-hmm.
Program.
United, that's what I thought. United States Marine Corps, the STA sniper,
surveillance and target. And that actually, STA Sniper, I do remember, if I remember correctly, is the drone, remote control drones, where they can take somebody out at a distance. Yeah.
Keep talking.
Military intelligence. And my favorite, information warfare. The term information warfare is primarily a United States military concept involving the use of and management of information and communication technology in pursuit of a competitive advantage over an opponent. Information warfare may involve collection of tactical information, assurances that one's own information is valid, spreading of propaganda or disinformation to demoralize or manipulate the enemy and the public, undermining the quality of opposing force information and denial of information collection opportunities to opposing forces. Information warfare is closely linked to psychological warfare. The United States military focus tends to favor technology and hence tends to extend into the realms of electronic warfare, cyber warfare, information assurance, and computer network operations, attack defense.
Yeah.
Wow. That was the one that stuck out, right, like a sore thumb to me, was the information warfare. And that's pretty much a tell-all. And the public, the enemy and the public. And when I see things like that, that means, and it always has, I have seen this before, the public is being viewed as the enemy.
Yeah, that's what I see too.
And this is nothing new to me. I have seen things like this in scripts and memos and different things that have come across my path in certain places in my life that read very similar to that. Enemy and public being pretty much squished into the same category.
So this thing reminds me of the data center, right? That mm-hmm. At the beginning. So it says ISTAR stands for Intel. And remember, all you have to do is put an H there and it'd be Ishtar.
That's what I was just about ready to say, that the fertility god, goddess Ishtar, that ISTAR. Actually, I believe ISTAR is actually another spelling of Ishtar anyway.
Oh, okay, so there you go. Mm-hmm. It works both ways. Stands for Intelligence, Surveillance, Target Acquisition, and Reconnaissance. In its macroscopic sense, ISTAR is a practice that links several battlefield functions together to assist combat force in employing its sensors in managing the information they gather. Information is collected on the battlefield through systematic observation by deployed soldiers and variety of electronic sensors. Surveillance, target acquisition, reconnaissance are the methods of obtaining this information. The information is then passed to intelligent personnel for analysis, and then the commander of his staff for the formulation of battle plans.
There you go.
It's processed information that is relevant and contributes to an understanding of the ground and the enemy dispositions and intents. ISTAR is the process of integrating the intelligence process with surveillance, target acquisition, and reconnaissance tasks in order to improve a commander's situational awareness and consequently their decision-making. In the inclusion of the L is imported as it recognizes, and that's an I, it recognizes the importance of the taking of information from all of the sensors and processing it into useful knowledge.
Yeah. And I can say that this is getting into territory where I could probably talk a lot about, but I can't. this is right up my alley. That's why a lot of this stuff sticks out to me, and I can pretty much say I can either confirm nor deny. But this is the kind of stuff that, let's just say, for all, you know, whatever. I have been known to be interested in reading about this.
At this, things I remember, I can talk about things that were given to me as introductory things, were things of the study of military tactics, things that read very similar to this, to at the beginning stages of what, where, when, and how, what's going on, and what my mind was going to be used for, where the military tactics are the science and art of organizing a military force, and the techniques for combining and using weapons and military units to engage and defeat an enemy in battle. Changes in philosophy and technology. My studies in philosophy really perked the ideas and interests of certain peoples. That's kind of what got me into what I was into. And my technological background as well, my abilities to my cognitive thinking and reasoning, my mechanical inclination, things I can talk about, anything they gave me for, you know, tests that would test my cognitive reasoning, my mechanical abilities, that I pretty much got, a 100, whatever, aced them, whatever you want to, there's different numbers to be used, but it didn't take long for somebody to pull me out, and this is why I kind of jump out and say things, because I did spend some time working I was working up to this type of thing, and I can either confirm or deny that I actually went anywhere with it. But this stuff is very real, and these are the things is why I after knowing the things that I know, a lot of times I don't even think about it, because I just recognize it for what it is, and I forget that other people are completely devoid of that. They don't see that they're being engineered. It's a social engineering program that's ever going on. And the public anywhere at this point, no matter what country you're in, is viewed as an enemy combatant first.
Yeah, exactly.
That is the first thing I can say that somebody would be trained up in, is the idea that the enemy and the general population are one in the same, that they must be handled in the same type of fashion and manner, basically. And that's why I became completely disgusted when I started really realizing certain aspects of life. I know I have to talk a little cryptic. I can't go into full detail, but when I have things up that I can read that have already been talked about, I can say a few things. But
You can help, lingo with this Jade Helm stuff, since you understand on that level.
Oh yeah, that's why I keep saying what I'm saying about Jade Helm. If this was something that was not meant to be known, it wouldn't be known. So therefore, the first question I have is, why did they make it public?
Yeah,
and that's where my mind starts from, because that is something that I would do if,
like a test.
I would want to gauge the response of the populace to such things, to see if there would be what type of outcry would come from the population, the public. And I would also do that to literally take the minds of critical thinkers that I know that are out there that see things and know a little bit more than others, minds completely off of something I do not want them to see. That is what I've been trying to hammer away at, is that I've tried to tell everybody this. This is a focal point that somebody wanted you to look at. Why? What is it that they don't want me to look at? That's the question I first asked when I, the first day I heard this, I said, what is it that I'm not supposed to see? What is being hidden from me? Because this is exactly what I would do to take...
Tunnels. I was thinking maybe it's the underground tunnels, because it seems that they're connecting the tunnels to the Walmarts.
Well, it could be something like that, and it could be multifaceted. It could be something that as a political faux pas, something going on that had very little coverage, that they wanted the populace of people, the critical thinkers that are out there, to not latch onto. That's why I've been trolling throughout the web and running and leaving searches running while I'm out doing what I do, to find things other than the Jade Helm 15. What other information is out there? What am I coming across that would be a pertinent information of something that the people don't want the public to see? And this is the type of situation that drop. This is like chess. You've ever played chess before?
Oh yeah, yeah, totally.
I'm very good at chess. It's the feigning, the move to keep the opponent looking at something else on the other end, and the whole time you're moving another piece, and you're trying to be very, very tactical about it to come in, doing an in and around to get your checkmate, or at least get a check, or get the queen. That's what this is.
Many moves ahead. So, like, that's what I see, too. I've been saying that a lot with people around me, is that this is like a chess game. It's like they're playing chess, and they're setting moves up ahead. It's like they're putting their pawn out to be taken out while they're going to have your queen.
Well, what I can't... one other thing, I just thought about this. I can say this, that 30 years ago, they didn't have the computing power that they have now. And I can say this because it actually has been released in the Freedom of Information Act, and it is out there to be found. I can't direct anybody to certain places. They have to find it on their own. But there are artificial intelligences now. This has been accomplished. They're not like Skynet or anything like that. This is like the beginning phases of that type of technology. But they have machines that think faster than a human brain.
Are they sentient?
No, they're not sentient.
They're not aware.
They're not aware, but they do very well. Then their main, the program it is that uses all the computing power that is available to it. It's a piece of software, essentially, that uses all the computer power that it has to calculate scenarios. It's a tactician's dream. It takes say you take a 3,000 scenarios. You plug in the information of 3,000 scenarios that you want to come up with, and you usually have a team of people that will do that. The think tank. And then it runs, and basically it's based on somebody's idea that came from somewhere else, from above. It came down. They want you to bust your brain and come out with scenarios. And then you type in the information into this machine, and it busts out sometimes hundreds of thousands, if not more, of scenarios that could possibly happen if this went down, if this was done a certain way, if a operation was put into, moved forward with. This machine gives you what a million brilliant minds couldn't give you in a snap of a finger. That's what they have. Then they have the social media that runs through. They have all of the background of everybody. Everybody's in the system, and it runs through everything. The best thing I can think of to actually compare it to is there's a show that I never watched, but I've read the premise of it. It's called Person of Interest.
Hey, I've seen that show.
and the computer that was developed, they have stuff like that. And I can't emphasize that more. It's already been released, so I can say that. It is there, and they use that, and they're using it against the public, you and I at this point.
Some would even argue that ARPANET was actually created for the building blocks, the substructure of such a system.
Yes, yes, thank you. I'm glad you mentioned that. Yes.
Circa 1967, I believe.
Yep, like, this has not been something newly thought of.
Yeah,
it's like, just the technology has evolved to be able to do it.
Yeah, we talked about that a few days back. I don't know. We did our first test broadcast on that new platform for our radio show, and we talked about that briefly. And like people think that it's new, as in the 90s with America Online, or the would-be president there. What was his name? I forget his name now. Ah, crap! You probably remember, but he said he invented the internet.
Oh, that would be the Al Gore.
Al Gore, that's it. Yeah, he invented the internet. My ass. But anyway, neither here nor there. But yeah, ARPANET's been around since 1967. People, like, I mean, well, that's when it was conceived, and that's when they started building it. And I think they literally used universities and all the brain power of the.
Oh, they still do.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
they still do. Right now, I know especially one, which I have friends that are still work with it. There is one at the University of Illinois that is used primarily by the Defense Department.
Doesn't surprise me.
It has got more computing power. It is, let's see if I could think of a good scenario of a size. Take a city block, let's say like New York, like a city New York block. They have a building on a block, and they have three floors that are filled with servers, blade servers.
Yeah, yeah.
That are all interconnected and being seen as one machine using a very interesting Linux, or a very evolved Linux that has been being played with for years now, to have this giant computing power. And this is one, and they have many across the entire nation and the world that they plug into.
Open source.
It's the yeah. NCSA, the National Center for Supercomputing Applications.
Thank you. That's it.
Yeah, interesting stuff for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a rabbit hole you can go way deep in.
Well, I've had my foot in the door. We got onto military tactics, and that's kind of where I can neither confirm or deny I know anything about it in some places. But that's where basically I could kind of like drum in the tactics part.
Be right back, guys.
You know, boom, I can see a lot of things. Just after you get stuff put into your head, it never goes away. You know, the real world, boom. It's like when Neo woke up. Wait a minute.
What is this? What is MOU and MOA?
MOU and MOA.
In relation to licensing agreements, training areas, station areas, role players.
That, I'm assuming,
false flag operations and or hoaxes.
I'm trying to remember what the acronym stands for, because I've heard them. But that was actually handled by soft. That's I think more on the software developer and like IT geeks, like hackers that they threatened with, 100 years in federal penitentiary. You can come work for us, type people. That's like those are those types of groups, which they do have as well, that write these types of programs, and of course MIT people and Harvard and where all these places, Caltech, and they bring people in from everywhere. They will take a self-educated hacker and bring them in, because the hacker would rather get paid $150,000 a year and have a house given to him and not go to jail and do stuff for the state. So, they've got all people from all walks of life that come in the thing, and I think that those fall into that category, which I can say that I do not have much knowledge of in that department, because that wasn't anything that I ever looked at.
That makes us understand. that does help though, because that makes us understand that that has to do with certain types of people that
for instance, another one, I actually did watch the movie all the years ago it came out, Eagle Eye.
Yeah.
Shia LaBeouf?
Yeah, the sentience isn't there. Is no sentient. There is no sentient computer. But
there could be.
The types of facilities and the types of people, yes.
And hey, Zigzag is saying MOA is military operating area, and MOU is military operating unit.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
It's in the chat, so.
Thank you, Zigzag. So, that helps. And then what's ID of training?
I would have no idea.
Sorry, guys, I'm back.
Yeah. What did I miss?
What's up, Rob?
MOA was explained.
It's MOA. Sorry.
Military operating area and military operating unit.
I will have to say that there are some. I had to sign like a stack. I mean, a hefty stack of non-disclosure papers. So some things I don't know exactly a good way to say without causing myself some grief. So I have to be kind of careful with some of this stuff. I have to kind of play dumb with it. So in a lot of instances, I'm going to act stupid about it and give very, very vague descriptions because I don't like the idea of being thrown into a room and having the room thrown away. Doesn't seem appealing to me.
That's understandable. So, I wanted to bring attention to this before I go, because I'm going to have to go soon.
Sorry, guys.
I wanted to just kind of go through this whole PDF online that's obviously there for us to find.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
that's the other thing that I just stuck out like a sore thumb to me. Why?
Well, they didn't put it out there for regular folks to find.
It was easy enough to find, though.
It's just for us, the ones that will look.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's as
everyone has what they need to know off the TV already.
Yeah.
A
word from our sponsors.
That's right. Well, I read this, and I think maybe some of you missed it, but military intelligence, and I just a brief description, and this is a good description. Military intelligence is a military discipline that exploits a number of information collection and analysis approaches to provide guidance and direction to commanders in support of their decisions. This is achieved by providing an assessment of available data from a wide range of sources directed towards the commander's mission requirements or responding to focused questions as part of the operational or campaign planning activity. In order to provide an informed analysis, the commander's information requirements are first identified. These information requirements are then incorporated into a process of intelligence collection, analysis, and dissemination. Areas of study may include the operational environment, hostile, friendly, and neutral forces, the civilian population in an area, or combat operations in other broader areas of interest. Intelligence activities are conducted at all levels, from tactical to strategic. In peacetime, the period of transition to war, and during a war itself. Mm. I mean, it basically, all through all of this, it's basically...
Is the AI involved with that?
What?
You're talking about? Is that AI involved?
It's being used by everybody. I mean, anybody that has access, that has the clearance to use this. It's like these giant supercomputers that are located all over the place are to access them. And how much time is given to certain entities, even like businesses and stuff,
can use this computing power and like put in a request a month in advance and say, we would like to use this for 5 hours on, you know, October 3rd or something like that, between the hours of, 1400 and, you know, whatever, you know. And they do that, and then they're like the DOD and whoever else has a lot more access. They can shut down civilian usage. So yes, this stuff is in play all the time. This giant network is used almost constantly, if not constantly, for computing power to be able to achieve the information gathering that they wish to have in any situation that they're working with.
Right. That's well, you know, and they always talk about it like on TV shows, like they always, like, you know, universities or not universities, but the students will request computing time.
Yeah.
Engineering
department might want to use it for a half hour to run some calculations
or some simulations on organics or entropy or something else, you know.
And there are times when basically it's inaccessible because some entity, and a lot of times that nobody knows, say, boom, well, you just squashed your ability to be able to access this for the next 3 days. You have no access. Come back later.
Yeah. Oh, man. The things you could do with that, eh?
They come out with these exercises all the time. What was it, like 2 or 3 years ago, they did that ELE 2011 thing, and it was kind of along the same lines. And
yep.
Then they went right into, like, Syria right after that, so I would be looking overseas as opposed to here.
That's what I'm thinking, too.
There's still the Ukraine situation going. There was hiccups in Iran, because didn't they just get a ship or something like that? And Japan also got taken off its, like, pacifist state, too, right?
Yeah.
So, I don't know what the fuck they're doing.
Yeah, the Iranian situation, we still don't know if it was actually a naval vessel.
Yeah.
If it was actually military or not, or if it was just some seafaring freaking cargo freighter.
Wow.
But as I've said before, you know, with this, before people came on, that within the description of military intelligence throughout the whole thing, you're going to find enemy and populace, they look at it the same. That's what I like to get people to understand, is that the Department of Defense is going to look at the population of the United States and any other population of any other country on the face of the earth as an enemy combatant. We are treated just like the enemy.
That's been around for, what, like 50 years, ever since the National Security Agreement happened? Of course.
Yes, of course, but not everybody knows that. A lot of people don't think that, you know, little Susie Q that's 19 running around texting while she's driving is possibly even being considered as an enemy combatant, as part of the populace, that the populace is actively being engineered, civil engineering. It's an ongoing program that's never ending, and it's
I agree 100%.
It comes from the military.
It's no surprise how they operate drones with controllers that either are exactly PlayStation controllers or Xbox controllers, or they resemble them somewhat.
Yep.
We talk about, you know, predictive programming in movies like film and what have you, and what their motives behind such things are. But, I mean, look at this, guys. It's blatant.
Well, it's commonly known that military intelligence is heavily involved in Hollywood.
Well, and it's funny that you say that, because a movie comes to mind from the 80s that you might be before some of your time, but you might
have games.
Remembered it. Nope. The Last Starfighter.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, yeah, I watched that.
Yeah, he gets recruited by a video game. He gets a top score, and next thing you know, he ends up joining some alien Federation war. And, like,
is that
you
Dennis
know,
Quaid?
No, Dennis Quaid was in a movie called Alien Mine.
Okay. That's it, yeah, Enemy Mine.
Enemy Mine, sorry. Yeah.
AMAC.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. The other one I can think of
that's newer is Stargate Universe.
Yeah.
They inducted a kid by playing a game.
Yeah.
They brought
what
him
was
in.
That, what was that new one? That
well,
came
he figured out,
with...
out a riddle. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
It was part of the game, yeah.
That new one with Harrison Ford and that little kid.
Ender's Game.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, yep. That was creepy because he gets to like destroy a whole place, making him think that he's just training for it.
Yeah.
Yep. And I think that actually, nothing I was ever involved in or ever would be involved in, if I would have been involved in something that I would know directly. But I do have my wonders if things like that actually do go on. That people think that they're doing something else when they're really doing something else.
I mean, I think it's happening all the time, to be honest with you. I mean, look at something like when they started up Homeland Defense. You know, you get regular people joining, like to be secretaries, to be custodians, what have you. They think they're doing, you know, they're taking part in something that isn't insidious in nature.
Well, but there is something that fits the bill perfectly for this.
Go for it.
A video game, and if I could remember the name of it, I can't. But it was a little game that was little known that actually was released by a software developer that had connections to the DoD. And the premise of the game was that you were in a suit because the environment was being changed by aliens. And
Crisis.
So you were going around and you were killing all of these aliens, and then right at the end, when some self awareness happens, I don't remember the exact premise, you took the helmet off and realized that you were killing human beings and you were actually fighting a war, killing off a civilian population somewhere. Huh. When the whole time you thought you were fighting aliens.
Wow.
I think it was Crisis.
It could be.
There was actually on the Outer Limits back in the day. There was an episode.
Oh,
much
that was
like
a
that.
Good show.
Remember that? Yeah. That was a good show. I found that to be kind of anti. I almost felt it to be anti, anti programming in a way. I for some reason I don't know. I had that show rubbed me the right way.
Well, you realize that it doesn't exist anymore, and they probably will never remake anything like that again.
No.
That stuff's gone. You don't find that. Everything is the social engineering now. Everything. Yeah, yeah. You got what that show Continuum.
Well, the only thing that isn't is what we're doing. Like this is like what? Yeah, we're the only ones, and I mean like we don't have the pull, which we should. Yeah.
Well, you got games like Call of Duty.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, come on. I mean, that isn't any more blatant than it is. It's a tell-all right there. That is absolutely a DoD project.
You know, a game creeped me out because A, it was so well done, and B, so much went into it, and C, it was so plausible, it wasn't funny, was All of Us? No, what was it called? End of Us? No, what the fuck was it called again? It was a PlayStation 3 title, big one near the end.
The Last of Us?
The Last of Us, thank you. Yeah, it was the...
Truth Media Revolution's site, channel. And this is some interesting predictive programming. Just watch this.
Go for it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't have the sound on. Let me fix that. Let me rewind it.
Derp.
Following a disputed election and a tie vote, the U.S. Congress installs the most unpopular president in U.S. history as David Jefferson Adams becomes the 44th president of the United
Jefferson
States.
Jefferson Adams?
Wow.
These times, rioting and a
nice
growing
hair,
number
bitch.
Of militias give rise to ever-increasing domestic terrorism. In response, the president invokes the Homeland Security Act and declares martial law on the West Coast and other areas of the country. Though a Supreme Court ruling sidesteps the electoral process, disqualifying popular presidential candidates from several states. Public outrage explodes when a sham election leads to incumbent David Adams accepting a second term in office. during the 57th Inauguration Day ceremonies, Washington, D.C. is
hit
by a low-yield nuclear weapon, killing David Abbott and most of the U.S. Congress.
CQ, QT.
The destruction of Washington, D.C. effectively breaks the chain of succession, sending the nation into chaos. In an emergency vote, the European Union deploys peacekeepers in the greater D.C. area to support international interests. With separatist sentiments rising, California governor has home rule.
It starts making me think about all those bunkers that are in West Virginia.
And declare sovereignty, taking neighboring states
like
with them
in
and forming the Republic of Texas. Now, the once United States of America lie in ruin. The time for words has passed, and a second American Civil War now erupts as seven factions wage war across the land. They battle one another to reclaim a nation, to restore peace, to rebuild this shattered union.
This is what I was talking about earlier, that the elite are going to go into their little holes in the ground, and they're going to unleash this type of shit and wait for it to resolve itself, and then come back out having control of all of the wealth and keep doing the same shit they're doing with less people and more of a subservient, battle-bewildered populace.
Apple, I got to take off. You're welcome to stay on. I could keep it on and, you know, just mute myself.
I'll probably take off, too. Thanks for having me, though, Fear Porn.
Okay, for sure.
Hey, I'm probably going to take off, too, because I'm going to get set up for doing a broadcast today. Anybody who's willing to come and join me, I'm on Skype. And actually, I just got assigned my my voice over IP phone number, which I do believe you can call in, and it doesn't charge me anything. So, but, I mean, long-distance rates might apply. I'm not sure. But I'm on Skype, though, Robert1974-1. So if you guys want to come in on Skype and join me in a little bit, go for it.
Cool.
That goes for anybody else out there.
Send me the link, Rob, man, and I'll, listen, because I'll be at work.
All right, cool. I will, for sure.
Did you say Robert1974-1?
Yep.
Try to go.
All right.
Yeah, go ahead and add me. I've got Skype fired up right now as it is. So
let me see here. Fire Skype up. Do a search.
All right. So then I'll just go ahead and end the broadcast. And it was great having you on, and it was great seeing you guys. Thank you for showing up in the chat. It's great having you there. Next time, come on to the panel and join us and have something to say. We might continue this because I had more to go into. Like, I have a bunch of articles and stuff. So, we should maybe do a part two next week. What do you guys think?
Sounds good to me.
And we'll probably have more to report because there'll be more going on with the whatever's happening. And
without a doubt, man.
So
I just, one thing that's really killing me is the Bloods and the Crips holding hands and skipping.
Oh, yeah. Singing Kumbaya and what have you.
That's it. What's happening next? Dogs and cats are going to start getting along together.
I don't know, man. We heard what happens in Ghostbusters when that happens.
Oh, no. The end of the world as we know it.
Remember, do your research.